Here we're going to talk about how to factor by grouping. So we're going to start off with something we already know how to do. Let's say you are asked to factor x times z plus y times z. So when I look at these two terms, I see that they have a common factor, and that common factor is z. And you can put a little check mark if you want, you know, above the z, just to kind of keep in mind what they have in common. And what happens to that common factor? Well, it gets factored out. So you're going to have z multiplied by x plus y. And notice that the common factor z shows up on the outside as a single z out there. Now this would be your answer, z times x plus y, right? And I can always check to make sure this is right by taking the z and distributing. Z times x gives x times z, right? Zx is the same as xz because multiplication is commutative. And also z times y is the same thing as y times z for the same reason. Now what we're going to do when we factor by grouping is we're going to make use of that same logic. So let me give you an example here. Let's say we wanted to factor and we had this. Let's say we had x cubed plus 3x squared plus 7x plus 21. Okay? So if you look at these, you might think to yourself, well, and think to yourself correctly, well, you have four terms, but they don't have anything in common, right? Because you might ask yourself, oh, do they have an x in common? Well, let's see. The first three terms have an x, but not the last one. And then you might try to think about, you know, a factor of 7, but only the last two terms have a factor of 7 in common. So the problem is that these four terms, they don't have any factor in common. So what we're going to do is we're going to focus on what we call grouping. So we're going to mentally associate these first two terms together. And you can put a little arc, if you want, under the terms that you're mentally grouping. So I'm going to mentally group those first two terms and then the second two terms. Now it's not always like this. It's not always 2 and 2. Sometimes later on we might take like 3 and 1. But most of the time, I'd say like maybe 90, 95% of the time, factoring by grouping works like this. You group the first two terms and the second two terms. You form two little groups like this. Okay, now, what do these first two terms have in common? Well, that would be just these two terms. That would be an x squared. So let's factor that x squared out of those two terms. So we've got x squared multiplied by, okay, what's left? Well, it would be x plus 3. Okay? Now, don't forget, this addition sign is still here. It's still plus right there. And then what do these have in common? Well, that would be a 7. So it's going to be 7 times x plus 3. Now, at this stage, we have not yet factored this polynomial. And the reason is because it's still a sum. Do you see that addition sign in the middle? That means we haven't yet factored it. Because when you factor it, you're looking at a product. Like above, right here, this is multiplication, and I know that this is a product. So even though these, you know, this and the last, even though these are products individually, the whole thing is a sum. But now what I'm going to do is I'm going to use the logic from the previous example. And do you see how these two terms had a z in common? Let me put a little check mark above what these have in common. They have an x plus 3, so right there, whoop, you can see that, an x plus 3 right there, and an x plus 3 right here. Do you see how they have the x plus 3 in common, the same way these had a z in common? Well, what do you do with what they have in common? And the answer is exactly what you did up here. You put it on the outside. So we'll put it on the outside, that is what they have in common. And that's the x plus 3. And then we ask ourselves, what's left? Well, up here, let me ask you, when we took out the z, what was left? Well, x, right? Because this term, if you will, we factored out the z. And then what happened in the next one when we took out the z, what was left? Well, the y. The same logic down here. When you look at this and you take out the x plus 3, what's left? Just x squared. And then for the next one, when you take out the x plus 3, what's left? and that would just be the 7, okay? So once you take out what they have in common, what you're left with here is what the individual terms had left over after you took out what they had in common. So I had a check mark, and a check on what they had in common, and let me put a check above the x plus 3 because that's what they had in common. Now this would be my answer. Notice how it's a product. They're multiplied together. So this technique we call factoring by grouping because we form two little groups early on. So even though that's not my final answer, you know, even though this is not the end, you still have one more step to do. That initial grouping process helped us factor the way we factored above, except the difference is we factored out a binomial, not simply a monomial. Okay, let's try another one like that. Okay, let's factor x cubed minus 5x squared minus 3x plus 15. So once again, I ask myself, what do they all have in common? And the answer is, well, there is no greatest common factor that I can factor out. So now I see that there are four terms, and factoring by grouping is often a good strategy when you see four terms. Let's write that down. When you see four terms, a nice strategy we often use is factoring by grouping. Okay, so we'll be on the lookout for that in the future. Whoops, factoring by grouping. Okay, so how does that work? Well, you mentally group the first two terms, right? So you mentally group those, and you mentally group the second two terms, or the second pair of terms, if you will. Okay, what do the first two have in common? Well, it's got to be, well, it is an x squared, right? So there's the x squared on the outside. And now once you factor out that x squared, what are you left with? Well, it's going to be an x. And then minus, well, let's see. Once you factor an x squared out of that, you're left with a 5. Okay, now remember how factoring by grouping works. We're hoping to get an x minus 5 appearing out of the next little group. Okay? And you might say, looking at these two, that they have a 3 in common. The only problem is if you factor out a 3, you'll be left with a negative x plus 5, and that's not the same as x minus 5. So what we do instead of factoring out just a positive 3, we factor out a negative 3. So what does this look like? A negative 3. And what are we left with? Well, negative 3 times what gives negative 3x? That would be x. And now the tricky part. Negative 3, right, because I'm mentally distributing this negative 3, and the negative goes with the 3. So negative 3 times what here gives positive 15? That's got to be a negative 5, and we write that as minus 5. And now we're in business because I can see that I have an x minus 5 here and an x minus 5 there. That is, they have that x minus 5 in common. Okay, so that means we can factor it out of both of them. So it's going to be x minus 5. And once we do that, what are we left with? Well, once I factor an x minus 5 out of this first term, I'm left with an x squared. And then minus, once I factor an x minus 5 out of this, I'm left with minus 3. Okay, and there I go. I have the x minus 5s, and I factored out. It's on the outside right here. And I'm left with x squared minus 3. Okay, and we factored this by grouping. Okay, let's try one more example just to make sure we've got it. Okay, so once again, I see that there are four terms, so I'm going to try factoring by grouping. So I'm going to group the first two terms, right? And by the way, when you put a little arc like this, and you can, it's totally fine to do this, you put a little arc under what you're grouping. The one thing we don't want to put in are parentheses, because when you put in parentheses, these have mathematical meaning. These little arcs are just here to tell us that we are mentally grouping the first two terms and the last two terms. They don't have any mathematical significance except to remind us what we're doing. Okay, so from the first two terms, I see that I have an x cubed. So I have an x cubed. That's what they have in common. And I'm left with, well, it's going to be an x plus 7. And now remember, I'm hoping to see an x plus 7, but I already have an x plus 7, so what do I do? And the answer is we employ this little trick. Notice that anything times 1 is always itself, so I can always write this, plus 1 multiplied by x plus 7. Now isn't that true? Isn't 1 times x plus 7 x plus 7? The reason I wrote it like this is that now I can regard the x plus 7 as a factor, and so I see they have a factor of x plus 7 in common. There's 1, and there's the same thing, right? They both have an x plus 7. So let's factor that out. And what am I left with? Well, I'm left with, and for the first one, it's going to be x cubed, right? And remember, I got the x cubed by asking myself, what, once I factor out the x plus 7, what am I left with? X cubed. And now for the next one, once I factor out the x plus 7, I'm left with a positive 1. Okay, now it turns out, for us right now, this will be our answer, and this is the end. But it turns out that in the future, this last factor happens to be what we call a sum of cubes. Okay, and it turns out that can be factored. And we'll do that in future videos. So when somebody asks us to factor, usually we want to keep going until we can factor no more. It turns out this can be factored further, but for right now, we can stop there simply because we're just concentrating on factoring by grouping. That's how factoring often goes. Often you employ one technique, and then there's more to be done after you've done that. Okay? So we'll see how to factor a sum of cubes in later videos. All right.